Have a Bible with you, invite you to open up to Romans chapter 8, if you would please, Romans chapter 8. And while you're turning there, I need to pass along a little bit of information. In the last couple of weeks, I have been told that there's a couple of additions to the church family on the way. A couple of ladies who are going to be bringing bundles of joy into the world that I had not known about previously. I think what it is we're just making sure we have job security for our nursery workers. And but along that line, even, Allie, when do you do? I can't hear you. May 7th. That's close to Mama's Day, ain't it? Uh-oh. Lord have mercy. And all these babies that are on the way, et cetera, et cetera. I think they're having a baby shower for you in a Tuesday week. Not this coming Tuesday, but the next Tuesday here at the church. Allie, is Eddie ready for this? Y'all look at Joffrey. Joffrey, the ones that are ready, he'll hold them, boil them, and send them home. And y'all go bet on it. Oh, Lord, help us. Thank the Lord for the additions to the families and the way God has blessed us. Over the last few weeks, other than the sermons that we preached relative to the Easter, which was about two or three sermons there, we've been in Romans chapter 8. Now, on two occasions over the last month, I have told you what other folk have said about Romans chapter 8. And I pointed out that there are some who've made comments about how that in a ministerial situation of ministers going to school and getting advancement in their studies, they wound up saying an alarmingly large number of them that Romans chapter 8 is the most significant chapter in the Bible. This last week, I was studying behind another author, William Willington is his name, and he wound up saying that of all the Bible for Christians, the book of Romans is the jewel of the Bible. It's the jewel. It's what stands out and shines in the book of Romans. It's because it's for us as Christians. Now, if you want to study history, go to the Old Testament. But if you want to study how the Christians ought to live and what we got and all these different blessings, go to Romans. And he also said, Romans chapter 8, if you're talking about the book of Romans being the jewel of the Bible, Romans chapter 8 is the diamond in the middle of the jewel. And so all of these ministers who are serious about their study in the Word of God come together and wind up saying Romans chapter 8 is extremely significant. It's important. There's doctrines and truths that are in this chapter that are amazing. And when you begin to realize that Paul put all these together in one spot, in one chapter, then you kind of maybe back up and realize there is something serious here. There's something special here. And it really is. I trust that you've been able to follow along so far with what we've tried to share. We've actually read the whole chapter already one occasion and talked about the fact that I personally like to get on down to about verse 30 and thereafter and get into where he's persuaded of this and that and all the confidence he has. And I like that. I just like somebody's got confidence in what they got, you know? My wife and I met a car dealer one time who had extreme confidence. We were living in Dodge County, and Tiffany was already born. She was a little baby, but we were driving a Nova with a V8 motor, and I realized I wish we had something to get better gas mileage, and so we heard about a Ford Fiesta. Y'all ever heard of a Ford Fiesta? Yeah, it's that cigar box. You know, really, it's more like a cigarette box. You know, it's a little bitty thing. And we went to the Ford dealership, going to get one of them things, you know, going to get good gas mileage, 40 miles to the gallon. And we got up there to the Ford dealer in Cochran, Georgia, and looked, and they had one Ford Fiesta left on the parking lot, just one, little white one. And I went to a dealer, one of the salesmen there, and he said, oh, yeah, that's a good car. I own one myself. I drive it. He started bragging. We started walking toward it. We got out there to it. And, you know, if you know what I'm talking about, it is literally a matchbox. It's little. And we got out there to it, and he opened the doors and started describing it and bragging on it and talking about how good it is and all this kind of stuff. And God is my witness, and my wife can back this up. He got in it, cranked it up, and it sounded like a sewing machine, you know, a little old bitty motor. And then he put it in gear, and it did not move one inch. And he did it again, boom. It didn't move one inch. He said, I know what it is. It's been sitting here a while, and the brakes are locked up. I'll fix that. And I watched this. He went and got another vehicle, come up behind it, and met the bumpers hit and bumped it. I thought, Lord, have mercy. It's a brand new car, and he's bumping it on the bumper already. But sure enough, it broke the brakes loose, and they would go. And he got in it, cranked that thing up, and it was moving. He went around the parking lot and then come back to us and picked us up. I got in the passenger seat. Susan and Tiffany got in the back seat. And he takes this little Ford Fiesta, and he pulls out onto the highway there just north of Cochran, Georgia, and he heads north on that highway. Run! Just, he literally, that little thing, he would bark in the tire. You know, they don't squeal. They just bark. And he was going through the gear, and we'd going down the road, and he was talking about how good it was, and how he drove one like it all the time. He said it's aerodynamic, And we were meeting a Big Mac dump truck. He gets over next to the center line so we can feel the full force of the wind, and but it takes it well. Then he turns it around in the middle of the highway. He does not take another road someplace. He gears it down, whips it around, and he's headed back toward the car dealership. Here we go again. We get back to the parking. I gotta be honest with you. That salesman absolutely, totally convinced me he liked that car. I did not buy that one. He wore it out already. But he convinced me. You understand? You see, one of the things I think we need to get out of Romans chapter 8 is a realization that if you study it and you get serious and don't just play games with it and you slow down, read it, and try to let God speak to you through Romans chapter 8, you're going to find out Paul has an absolute confidence in God and in the Word. And it's amazing what he winds up doing. Now, what I want us to do as quickly as we can, and I promise you I'm going to try to be quick. That don't mean a whole lot, but I promise it. But if you look in your bulletin, I've tried to list some of the things about Romans chapter 8 that are good. If you were here already, heard some of these other sermons I preached out of here, I have touched on and pointedly and with reason the sad side of it. He talked about how we're going to die and how that we're going to go through persecution, and it's not always going to be rosy and sweet and kind. Like in verse 36 of Romans chapter 8, it said, as it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Now that ain't a good verse. We're going to die. I don't want to be killed. But now, the negative, that's the wonderful thing about the Word of God. God does not pull punches with us. If you're willing to read the book and not just listen to some preachers will say, all they want to do is pick out the sweet, nice, and kind and talk about how good God is and how good it'll be for you. And if you'll just come to Calvary, your burdens will roll away. That preacher is a false preacher. I'm sorry, that is not the teaching of the whole Word of God. He deals more with the troubles and the trials than he does with the blessings. And we've got to be honest about that. Well, now here in this chapter, Paul gets very serious about these things, and I hope you can see them as we try to run through them. It's going to be Romans chapter 8. We're going to start off with verse 1, but let's bow for prayer before we even read. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for loving us. I thank you for giving us your precious word. I thank you, God, that even though I do not understand it all, I have already learned I can trust it all. I thank you, God, that your word is true and accurate, and the prophecies are going to be fulfilled. Lord, one day, one way, somehow, every single word will come to pass. And I pray, God, that you'd help us to realize these scriptures that talk about past times and the things that have already happened or the things that are happening now, may we realize, God, they're true too. And Lord, that we might be able to base our very lives on what you teach us. Now, help us to learn. Help us to be able to absorb into our very soul the teachings that you've got for us for your glory, your honor, your praise. It's because you're worthy. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you notice in your bulletin, I listed there 8 different things that we gain as being Christians that are listed in this chapter. Now, there's obviously I could go elsewhere and get other things, but here it's amazing to me that Paul sees fit to put 8 of these wonderful teachings all together. And let's look at verse 1 through 4 says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. One of the things I would say to you, first of all, is an exciting thing about being a Christian is our position. the where we are. You know, everybody, don't you like to go to the middle of the field when you go to a ball game, the 50-yard line or someplace like that, or behind the dugout if you're at a baseball game, and get a good seat so you can see what's going to happen. I got a tip for you. In Christ, we've got the best position. We are in the Lord. In Christ. Have you let that thought sink in? Do you understand where you are as a born-again person? You are, according to the Bible, in Christ. You know, what's that old idea? Well, you know, you wonder if somebody can take you and send you down to hell. Well, in order to get to you, you are in Christ, locked down. Christ is in God the Father, locked down. I got a tip for you, friend. Ain't nothing getting to you. A couple of weeks ago when we were down in the lower part of the chapter and we read those verses down there, it talked about how can anybody come between us and God? Who's going to do that to us? And I preached on them in the direction of talking about how that some people are bullies. It was a Sunday night a couple of weeks ago. And I pointed out here in Paul's writing to the Romans, he let them know there's going to be some folks who are going to try to condemn you. There are going to be some folks who are going to talk bad about you. There are going to be folks who try to talk negative and put you down. But you are in Christ. And because you are in Christ, they got to go through Jesus to get to you. Now, what about that? And that's verse right here, verse 1 where it says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ. Y'all know what that's saying? Condemnation. The word is actually used three times here in Romans chapter 8. It's used in verse 1, verse 3, and verse 34, the word condemn or condemnation. And here is where it's talking about how for us who are in Christ, ain't nobody able to condemn us. And that's what Paul was talking about in those further verses down there. Who can accuse you? Who can put you down? It's God that loves you. It's Jesus that died for you. It's Christ that rose from the grave. And what does it matter what the world said? Y'all catch this? What does it matter what the folks out there in the world who are going to hell, what does it matter what they say about you and me? And they try to belittle us and put us down and mock us and make fun. If we are in Christ, who are they? Jesus is the one that protects us. Oh, man, hold on. But now, wait a minute. I want you to see this also. You do understand what the word condemnation means. You've been condemned. You've been found guilty. Condemnation is on you. Well, we're all sinners. No exceptions. I don't care who you are, how good you are, how smart you are, how much you... I don't care. You're a sinner. There's none righteous, no, not one. We are all sinners. But I got a tip for you. Because we get in Christ, and that word in Christ, you get in Jesus, you get saved, then the condemnation doesn't mean anything. There is no condemnation to them which are in Christ. Hold on. Let me show you. I want you to see this for yourself. That verse right there. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. I got a tip for you. Y'all, you ready for this? If you're willing to read the Bible and study it seriously, let me show you a little tip here. There is therefore, next word. Let's do it again. Next word. Now. Y'all didn't get that, did you? I didn't get it. There is, therefore, now, no condemnation to them that are in Christ. Hey, all my sins, woo, been gone. I have to go to God and ask, I'm one of these, my personal opinion is, the day I accepted Christ as my Savior, he put my name up there in glory, I'm going to heaven, and thereafter, I have to be careful. I do believe that I need to ask God to forgive me daily for those things which I do wrong, momentarily, if you want to get the truth about it. When I do something wrong, I need to ask God to forgive me for it, and I will sin. 1 John was written, chapter 1, verse 9, was written to Christians. If we have sin in our life, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That verse was not written to lost people. I will continue to use it in witnessing, but it was written to saved folks because God knows us saved folks gonna blow it. Yes, you are, every now and then. But now, wait a minute. Even though I blow it, there is now, no condemnation. In other words, he who has the power and the authority and the ability to condemn me, he's not going to do it.
He's not going to do it because he's already forgiven me. Oh, whoa, 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 whoa. N-O-W. Oh, he's going to take care of my sins when I get to heaven and I talk to him there at the judgment seat. Then he's going to take care of all my sins and I'll get into heaven. No! He takes care of those sins now. Have you got that? It's not a case of, well, I mean, I can remember talking to some very dear, sweet church-going folk. Well, Brother Darrell, I hope I make it to heaven. I'm doing the best I can. I'm trying. I plan on being there. They don't understand. Because of what Christ Jesus has already done and what we do when we ask him to forgive us for our sins and be our Savior, what he does, he takes all the sin and he deals with it. Glory! Can you handle that? You got that? There is therefore now no condemnation. Not talking about 20 years from now or 50 years from now when we kick the bucket, there'll be no condemnation to those of us then when we get to glory. Fine. No, no, he said there's not any now. That's important. That's important. I have to believe every word of the Word of God. But now, let's see here. We're in this new position. We are in Christ. Just in Jesus. Ain't that good? Some of you don't know how good it is. You just don't know. One day you're going to realize it. To be saved and to be in Christ. No, whoa. I need to do this. Christ. When it says we are in Christ, you know who Christ is, right? Do you know the different titles that have been given to Jesus? Different words that have been used to determine and define who he is? Jesus, the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then you drop down to verse 14 in chapter 1 of John, and verse 14 says, and the Word became flesh, and we beheld his glory as the only begotten of the Father. I got a tip for you, friend. If we are in Christ, are you ready for this? I'm fixing to pitch you with something. Here you go. You ready? If we are in Christ, we are in the Word. Y'all catch that, right? You pick it up and you get in it. You take your mind, your brain, and you put it in the Word of God. You let the teachings of the Bible, the scriptures that are there, you let them fill your mind. We are in Christ. Now what it says there, if we are in Christ, it's okay, no more condemnation. Those bullies of the last part of chapter 8 of Romans, those bullies who condemn us and ridicule us and mock us and make fun of us, they don't mean anything. We're with Jesus and he's everything. He's the one who can handle it. Well, not only that, I'm trying to show you some good things and I'm probably messing up. Anyway, the second thing I'll show you begin with verse 5. Romans chapter 8 beginning with verse 5 and following. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace, because the carnal mind is enmity against God. For it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God, but ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live after the flesh. For if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if we through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. Hold on. Second promise that we got here. We have a new entity living in us. I can't understand this. I cannot properly explain it. I just want you to understand something. I absolutely, totally, completely believe in God's Holy Spirit. I absolutely, totally believe that God's Holy Spirit somehow comes from glory and comes in. Can I get a nod if you agree with me? You understand what I'm saying? You understand that I'm talking about the third part of the Godhead, the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And God the Holy Spirit actually comes to live inside of us. Hey, that's good. I walk around with the third part of God Almighty, the Creator, the Sustainer, the Prince of Peace, the Judge that's coming. He's always with me. I'm never alone. No, never alone. Y'all got that? You ever been where you thought you was alone? Uh-uh, not if you're saved. Never alone. Uh-uh. Oh, my. Well, now, what I'm seeing here is that these verses of Scripture are talking about how that we have a new guest inside of us, God's Holy Spirit. And that's what he's talking about here in these verses of Scripture. This guest has come to live inside of us. Well, now, let me show you the next thing. Have you ever wanted a new family? Don't answer that. Some of you teenagers get in trouble in a hurry. You think, if my mom and a new family. Being a Christian, look at verses 14 through 17. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. You've been adopted. I've been adopted. Now, that's special. That's really special. See, Tiffany, Kristen, and Heather didn't have no choice. They got stuck. God just put them in our family. But if we were to adopt somebody, if we were to go out there and adopt somebody, then we would be choosing them. Knowing them, we'd say, yes, we want them. Tiffany, Kristen, and Heather didn't have any choice in the matter. They just got stuck. But those who are adopted have been singled out by the adopters and said, we want you. We want you as a part of our family. I got a good tip for you. We've got a big family, the family of God. Now, I do trust you understand. That doesn't mean we're all perfect, right? Families have their disagreements. Y'all probably don't. Y'all probably have such a perfect life, you don't know what it means to have a family fuss, argument, or disagreement, or whatever. But listen, when we get adopted, that means that we've been chosen. Despite what we are or what we've done, we've been singled out and they've said, we want you. And God Almighty has singled out Daryl Quinn with all of his ungodliness and filthiness. And God Almighty said, I want Daryl Quinn to be a part of my family. I adopt Daryl. He's in the family now. That's good. That's good. And so it's true for you. Now, I'm showing you something here. These scriptures are talking about what we've got as Christians. We get to be in Christ, a new position. We get to have God's Spirit in us, a new guest. And we get to be a part of a new family, the family of God. Now, hold on. Not only that, verses 18 through 25, if you would, please. Verses 18 through 25. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope, because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body. That is, the word adoption here means the completion of it. Not just the being a part of the family in name, but when it actually becomes real. In verse 24, for we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for it? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. Wait for what? The second coming. The second coming. Something that happens to us as New Testament believers, we have the joy, the earnest expectation inside of our hearts in looking forward to a day when the trumpet will sound. Is that a good thought to you? Are you listening? Huh? What if that thing was to sound right now? You going with me? You going to hang around? Hey, I got a tip for you. If you're still here, shut the doors. I'll be gone. Wait a minute. All of creation, all of earth, is earnestly groaning and travailing. If the idea is like a woman fixing to give birth to a child, you know, the travailing, the pain, the agony, the expectation, we're going to get this over. And one day that trumpet's going to sound. And one day that angel is going to shout. And one day we're going to split the sky. And we're going to, as the word of God teaches, we will meet our loved ones in the air. Those that have died before us in Christ as Christians, they're going to come up out of those graves. I heard one preacher say, well, they're going to come up first and then we'll go. I don't know. You know, they say, well, we got a 6-foot start on them, so they got to go up first. I don't know. It really don't matter. I'm going to meet them in the air. I am. We had Tinley at the house yesterday morning, and she went over by the fireplace, and we got a stack of books over there, family albums, pictures. And she pulled out some and was running around saying, I know who this is. I know. And what was it she said? I don't look like I used to look. I can't believe she said that. You know. And she a picture of when me and Susan got married, you know, and for some reason she thinks I don't look the same anyway, and all this stuff. But she brought over there to me, we got one book that we fixed, that Tiffany fixed, on my dad's 80th birthday. And it's just a pile of pictures and comments about my dad. And he loved the fish, and probably the majority of the pictures in that book are him with a fish or in a boat or something like that. And just what he enjoyed. And I looking through that, and I was thinking yesterday morning, one day, are you ready? One day, the earnest expectation, the hope, the whoa, look out, here it comes. Jesus calling us, and we meet our loved ones again. What a day that will be. Boy, I wish I could sing for your sake. I'd take off and I'd let roll. That's a thought. Don't you understand? We are saved, and because we are saved and in the family of God, we genuinely, it's not just a hope. It is not just a hope. I don't want hope. I'm sorry. Y'all mark it down. All y'all listening to this preacher right now, I want you to write this down. Darrell Quinn does not want hope. I don't. If all we have is hope, we are of all men most miserable. I want confidence. I want assurance. I want a no-so relationship with God Almighty so that I know if that trumpet sounds, boogity boogity, I'm leaving. What are you going to do? Well, I hope I'm ready. You'll bust hell wide open with a thought like that. Get saved, friend. Get saved. Born again is what Jesus called it. It's an event in your life. It's a time and a place where you decide, I don't want to go to hell. I want to go to heaven. And I ask Christ to forgive me for my sins and be my Savior. And I mean it. That gives us an earnest expectation. Not just a hope. Oh, no. Let's get that straight. You're expecting it. I don't know what. You know what? I bet you I'm right on this. If I was a betting man, I'd bet on it. Every penny I got. Most of the people in this room right now, are you listening to me? Most of the people in this room right now, you don't want Jesus to come back. Not today. You got something else you want to do. Got someplace you want to go. I hate to tell you, I hate to admit this. I remember when we were first married and living in Warner Robins. And we had a revival. An evangelist by the name of Moody came to our church and preached a revival. And he was one of these world evangelists. Had been to Russia and preached over in Russia in the Red Square and all that kind of junk. And he used all kinds of facts and figures and brought all that stuff back to Second Baptist Church. And he got up there and he talked about how many submarines the Russians have got, how many missiles they've got on those submarines, and where those missiles are aimed. We was in Warner Robins, Georgia, Robins Air Force Base. Kind of a big deal. We knew. They didn't try to mince words about it or play games around it. We knew. If we ever got in an argument with them boys over yonder, they were going to be something headed for us. And we knew it. Matter of fact, tell you the truth, there was one night in the middle of the night, we thought it happened. There was a B-52 sitting on the runway at Robins Air Force Base, and some airmen were fueling up that B-52 and got it almost full
of fuel, and what I was told is one of them lit a cigarette. You heard the explosion for 10 miles. We thought the bomb had been dropped. I'm serious. We thought it's on. But now, see, we knew that if it ever got on, we weren't going to be around to be when it was over. They were going to make a hole in middle Georgia, and there was no doubt about that. And I can still remember during that revival, Susan and I went to a friend's house named Tommy and his wife, and it was about 6 or 7 young couples. All of us, none of us had any children yet. We was all young married couples. And I remember we gathered around in the living room and we sat on the floor after that revival service drinking some Coke or tea or something. And we were sitting there talking, and we got to talking about how soon Jesus could come. How near, man, I'm talking about 1975 or 6. You realize how long ago that was? And we expect, you know, I hate to say this to you. This is inappropriate for me even to have to admit this. I remember sitting on that floor, looking around that room at them other guys, and we all played ball together, baseball, softball, football, something, whatever. And our wives, we was all good friends, and we were sitting there. But you know what I was thinking? God is my witness, I hate this. Lord, I would like to catch 10 one-10-pound bass before I go. Isn't that crazy? You ever heard anything dumber? I'd have to think, I didn't admit that to them. No, I didn't bring that up. It's a thought that went through my head. I like to hunt and fish. I never caught a 10-pound bass. And I just would like to catch one 10-pound bass before the trumpet sound. But I got a tip for you. I know in this room right now, the majority of the people sitting in front of me, you don't want Jesus to come back today. You got something you want to do. Someplace you'd like to be. Or maybe you'd be honest enough to say, I'm not sure I'm ready. What's your case? There is a God. His name is Jesus. And he said, I'll be back. He did. He told them that, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Expectation. You got it? Do you have an earnest desire inside of you for the sound of that trumpet? I witnessed to a boy up in Dodge County. His name was Jeffrey Turner. And I loved him. Did his wedding. Good kid. Just class A redneck, okay? Multi-redneck. He's a young fella. He would go visiting with me. And we were getting ready for revival, and we were going through the community handing out little flyers door to door. And I took Jeffrey with me. And we went up to this house out in the country, and we pulled up in the driveway. I looked, and a teenage girl came to the screen door. Y'all remember when you used to have the screen doors with a spring on them? And bang! Was this teenage girl came to the screen door, and she was standing there. And we've been taking turns going up to the doors and handing out these invitations to revival. And Jeffrey was sitting off over here, and I was driving. He looked and said, I got this one, Rev. And a teenage girl had come to the door. He got out, and he went around my ranchero and walked around the front of it and started walking up the walkway toward the front door. He was strutting. You'd have thought he had been on some movie or something. He was strutting. And there was a German shepherd dog laying in the grass in the front yard, just laying there. They wasn't doing nothing wrong. Dog just laying there looking at him. And he walked by that dog 4 or 5 feet from him. Dog just lay there and watched him. He walked all the way up to the door. That little girl pushed open that screen. He handed her that little piece of paper and said, you're invited to revival at our church next week. Just want you to know it. He straightened up, turned around, started walking back toward the ranchero. And he got about halfway down, which was just about beside that little old dog, German shepherd little dog. And he looked down and went, rawr. He ought not have done it. That girl's still standing up there on the other side of the screen door. She's watching. And he realized that dog was coming up. Jeffrey took off. When he got to my, y'all ever seen the Dukes of Hazzard commercial? I am not kidding you. That boy got to my car.
He leaped up on the hood, slid across the hood, did exactly like they do in the commercial. He hit the ground, and his head come in the window. Whoom! And his head went down in the floorboard. His feet were stuck up in the air. He was twisting and turning and trying to get straightened up. That German shepherd standing outside looking in the window at him. And he finally gets turned around, straightened up, and he sits down. He's out of breath. And I looked at him and said, Jeffrey, that ain't no way to impress girls. Oh, but I got a tip for you. You know what Jeffrey did? When I witnessed to him about getting saved, and I talked to him about Christ's coming back, I said, one day, Jeffrey, you're going to be driving down the road or somewhere, and that trumpet's going to sound. Are you ready? I'm not kidding you. On a youth retreat over in Columbus, Georgia, at Three Lakes, I witnessed to him about that. The next week in Eastman, Georgia, he's driving down the main street in town, and some redneck in Eastman, Georgia, had bought a new horn and put it on their truck. You know what it did? It blowed a trumpet, and somebody got behind Jeffrey the next week, hit that horn. Jeffrey thought it just happened. Next week, I had the privilege of seeing him get saved. What does it take to get you scared? What does it take to get your attention? I want you to understand something. Go home, read Romans chapter 8. Man, I ain't even halfway through what I was going to try to say this morning. And read it and realize God is giving to you and me all these wonderful things. But you have got to make up your mind. You want it or you want to go to hell. That's the way it is. There is no in between. You either go to heaven or you go to a lake of fire. And it's your choice. Christ has already made a way for you to make it, but it's your call. What will you do? What will you do? Let's bow for prayer. Lord, so many wonderful things you've given to us. So many wonderful promises. God, I thank you for them. But Lord, I pray this church would realize that through Christ we are more than conquerors. It's through Christ we can be victorious. Even death itself is defeated. Thank you, Lord. May your will be done in this room. May we humble ourselves before you and allow you to be not just someone we know about, but Lord, may we let you be our Savior, our Master. For your glory and our good. For it's in Jesus' sweet name I pray.